friendship and affection I need to feel my father smiling on me. The only name that matters to me. Aim for the Lord's perfection. 2 Corinthians 13. Paul, for perfection, listen to my appeal, be of one mind, live in peace, and the God of love and peace be with you. 1 Corinthians 13:8. Love never fails, but where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. 1 Corinthians 14, follow. Follow the way of love and eagerly desire spiritual gifts, especially the gift of prophecy. For anyone who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men, but to God. Indeed, no one understands him. He utters mysteries with his spirit. But everyone who prophesies speaks to men for their strength and encouragement and comfort. He who speaks in a tongue edifies himself, but he who prophesies edifies the church. I would like every one of you to speak in tongues, but I would rather have you prophesy. He who prophesies is greater than the one who speaks in tongues, unless he interprets. So that the church may be edified. Now, brothers, if I come to you and speak in tongues, what good will I be to you unless I bring you some revelation or knowledge or prophecy or the word of instruction? Even in the case of lifeless things that make sounds, such as the flute or harp, how will anyone know what tune is being played unless there is distinction in the notes? Again, if the trumpet does not sound a clear call, who will get ready for the battle? So it is with you. Since you are eager to have spiritual gifts, try to excel in gifts that build up the church. Brothers, stop thinking like children. In regards to evil, be infants, but in your thinking, be adults. What then shall we say, brothers, when you come together? Everyone has a hymn, or a word of instruction, a revelation, a tongue, or an interpretation. All these must be done for the strength and strengthening of the church, 1 Corinthians 15. Therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm, let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. James 2:24. You see, a person is justified by what he does, and not by faith alone. As a body without the Spirit is dead, so faith without deeds is dead. Therefore, do good deeds and help build up the church in faith. Through the Spirit, love and peace, and gifts of the Spirit pouring through the Lord. James 3:18. Peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness. Amen. Amen. get my songs done so y'all can download them. Done this week. My son will probably be a day late too because he's going out of town and he's in charge of my site. Okay, now, this week's sermon is called Aim for the Lord's Perfection. As in 2 Corinthians 13. I, Apostle Paul, aim for protection. Listen to my appeal. Be of one mind. Live in peace. And the Lord of God and the God of love and peace be with you. 1 Corinthians 13:8. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. We know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child, reasoned like a child. When I became a man, which is an adult, I put childish ways behind me. Now we see but a poor reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest is love. 1 Corinthians 14. Follow the way of love, as in brotherly love, and eagerly desire spiritual gifts, especially the gift of prophecy. For anyone who speaks in tongue does not speak to men, but to God himself. Indeed, no one understands him. He utters mysteries with his spirit. But everyone who prophesies speaks to men for their strengthening, encouragement, and comfort. He who speaks in a tongue edifies himself. But he who prophesies edifies the church. I would like every one of you to speak in tongues, but I would rather have you prophesy. He who prophesies is greater than the one who speaks in tongues, unless he interprets, so that the church may be edified. Now, brothers, if I come to you and speak in tongues, what good will I be to you unless I bring you some revelation, or knowledge, or prophecy, or word of instruction? Even in the case of lifeless things that make sounds, such as the flute or harp. How will anyone know what tune is being played unless there is distinction of the notes? Again, if the trumpet does not sound a clear call, who will get ready for the battle? Excuse me. So it is with you. Since you are eager to have spiritual gifts, try to excel in gifts that build up the church. Brothers, stop thinking like children. Stop thinking like children in regard to evil, be infants. But in your thinking, be adults. What then shall we say, brothers? When you come together, everyone has a hymn, or a word of instruction, or revelation, a tongue of interpretation. All of these must be done for the strengthening of the church. 1 Corinthians 15, therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord. Because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. James 2:24. You see a person is justified by by what he does. He does. And not by faith alone, not by faith alone, by faith alone. As the body. Excuse me. Without the spirit, as the body without the spirit is dead. So faith without deeds is dead. Therefore do good deeds and help build up the church in faith through the fruit of the spirit, which I've been teaching you, love and peace and the gifts of the spirit for and through the Lord. James 3:18. Peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest in righteousness. Amen. Now let's pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive everyone that's indebted to us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Remember, I've been teaching you, and I've told you in the past, this is also from newcomers. Three times I should be dead. Twice I had cancer. Once I had no death experience. The last time I had cancer, I got down on my hands and knees. I just cried, fasted, prayed to God for days. I meditated for days. I just cried, screamed like a newborn baby. I just screamed and cried for days. I submitted myself to God, our Heavenly Father. Then my tumors disappeared. I made him a promise to preach the gospel, the real God's truth. And when I had no death experience, when I had one of my kids, I woke up covered in blood. I went to heaven. I seen Jesus Christ, heaven, and hell. The devil, I seen both places. So there really is both places. So who or what you truly love, serve, follow here is your God. Whether you love this world and its cravings of sinful man, of what you see and hear here as a God is where you're going to end. If you love God, our Heavenly Father, love and serve and follow Him, be faithful to Him here, and you inherit eternal life with Him. So remember that. Amen. Okay, now get your Bibles out, everyone. Excuse me, like I said, I have severe allergies. It's been really severely dry lately, so I got a scratchy throat. Exodus 20 is the Ten Commandments. Abide and obey by them. To shame, who are treacherous without excuse. Show me your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths, your paths. Guide me to your truth, and teach me. For you are God, my Savior, and my hope is in you all day long. Remember, O God, O Lord, your great mercy and love, for they are from above. Remember not the sins of my youth and my rebellious ways. According to your love, remember me, for you are good, O Lord, are good, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord, the Lord. Therefore, he instructs sinners in his ways. He guides the humble in what is right and teaches them his way. All the ways of the Lord are loving and faithful, are loving and faithful. For those who keep the demands of his covenant, for the sake of your name, O Lord, forgive my iniquities, though it is great. Who then is the man that fears the Lord? He who instructs him in the way chosen for him. He will spend his days in prosperity, and his descendants will inherit the land. The Lord confides in those who fear him. He makes his covenant known to them. My eyes are ever on the Lord, for only he will release my feet from the snare. Turn to me and be gracious to me, for I am lonely and afflicted. The troubles of my heart have multiplied. Free me from my anguish. Look, look upon my affliction and my distress, and take away all my sins. See how my enemies have increased, and how fiercely they hate me. Guard my life and rescue me. Let me not be put to shame, for I take refuge in you. May integrity and uprightness protect me, because my hope is in you. Redeem Israel, God, from all their troubles.
Pursue it. The eye of the Lord are on the
righteous. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are attentive to their cry. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to cut off the memory of them from the earth. In other words, they'll die in the earth, just like you're at the cemetery. You just end up in the earth. That's it. Amen. Amen. Eternal life with God, our Heavenly Father. He delivers them from all their troubles. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. A righteous man may have many troubles, but the Lord delivers him from them all. He protects all his bones. Not one of them will be broken. Evil will slay the wicked. The foes of the righteous will be condemned. So the righteous will be condemned. Okay, excuse me. The wind's blowing my pages. The Lord redeems his servants. His servants, be a servant. Amen. No one will be condemned who takes refuge in him. Take refuge in him. Amen, amen. Okay. Wind's a little cold, so excuse me. Okay, excuse me. The servant of the Lord, Isaiah 42. The servant of the Lord, Isaiah 42. We studied that a couple weeks ago. Daniel in the lion's den, and his strong faith in God protected him. We studied that, Daniel 6. Trust in him. Amen, amen. He will guide you, protect you, and shield you through all your trials and tribulations here. Remember, WWJD, what would Jesus do? Remember that as you go through all your trials and tribulations here. Remember on money, paper money and coins, it says in God we trust. So put your trust in him. Amen, amen. So we can make it to our eternal home at the end and live with him and live in love, peace, joy, and there's light everywhere. Amen, amen, throughout eternity. Okay. Now I'll be teaching you people of the Bible and judge, mock, ridiculed, laughed at, spit upon. And they flogged and killed Jesus Christ, all by and from. Strong faith in God, our Heavenly Father. Amen, amen. My heart. the people to repent them. He be sent to the cross and let them die. And let them follow me, faithful God, Heavenly Father. Now there were some present at the time who took Jesus from the Galileans who were Pilate had mixed with their sacrifice. Jesus answered, "Do you think that these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered this way? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you will all perish. You will all perish," in other words, die. "Or those 18 who died when the Tower of Siloam fell on them, do you think they were more guilty than all the others living in Jerusalem? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will perish, die." Then he told this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he went to look for fruit on it, but did not find any. So he said to the man who took care of the vineyard, "For 3 years now, I've been coming to look for fruit on this fig tree and haven't found any. Cut it down. Why should it use up the soil?" "Sir," the man replied, "and leave it alone. For one more year, I'll dig around it and fertilize it. If it bears fruit next year, fine. If not, then I'll cut it down." Excuse me. On the Sabbath, Jesus was teaching in one of the synagogues. And a woman was there who had been crippled by a spirit for 18 years. She was bent over and could not straighten up at all. When Jesus saw her, he called her forward and said to her, "Woman, you are set free from your infirmity." Then he put his hands on her, and immediately she straightened up and praised God. Indignant, which means angry, because Jesus had healed on the Sabbath, the synagogue ruler said to the people, "There are 6 days for work, so come and be healed on those days, not on the Sabbath." The Lord answered him, "You hypocrites! Doesn't each one of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or donkey from the stall and lead it out to give it water? Then should not this woman be a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has kept bound for 18 long years, be set free on the Sabbath day from what bound her?" Then he said this. When he said this, all his opponents were humiliated, but the people were enlightened with all the wonderful things he was doing. Jesus teaches about the kingdom of God, and Jesus said, "What is the kingdom of God like? What shall I compare it to? It is like a mustard seed, which a man took and planted in his garden. It grew and became a tree, and the birds of the air perched on it, on its branches." Again he asked, "What shall I compare the kingdom of God to? It is like yeast that a woman took and mixed into a large amount of flour until it worked all through the dough." Jesus teaches about entering the kingdom. Then Jesus went through the towns and villages teaching as he made his way to Jerusalem. Someone asked him, "Lord, are only a few people going to be saved?" He said to them, Make every effort to enter through the narrow gate, because many, I tell you, will try to enter and will not be able to. Once the owner of the house gets up and closes the door, you will stand outside knocking and pleading, "Sir, open the door for us." But he will answer, "I don't know you or where you come from." Then you will say, "We ate and drank with you and taught in the streets." But he will reply, "I don't know you or where you come from. Away from me, all you evildoers. There will be weeping there and gnashing of teeth, which is in hell. When you see Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and all the prophets, in the kingdom of God, but you yourselves thrown out. People will come from the east and the west, the north and the south, and take their places at the feast in the kingdom of God. Indeed, there are those who are last will be first, and the first will be last." Jesus grieves over Jerusalem. At that time, some Pharisees came to Jesus and said to him, "Leave this place and go somewhere else. Herod wants to kill you." He replied, "Go tell that fox." We read this a couple weeks ago, but this is for the newcomers. "I will drive out demons and heal people today and tomorrow, and on the third day, I will reach my goal. In any case, I must keep going today and tomorrow and the next day, for surely no prophet can die outside Jerusalem. Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how often I have longed to gather all your children together, as the hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. Look, your house is left to you desolate. I tell you that you will not see me again until you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.'" Amen. Okay. Excuse me. Ma'am, I've been teaching you on praise, okay, and this is also for the newcomers. John 5:41. Jesus said, "I do not accept praise from men, but I know you. I know that you do not have the love of God in your heart. I have come in my Father's name, and you do not accept me. But if someone else comes in his own name, you accept him. How can you believe if you accept praise from one another? Yet make no effort to obtain the praise that comes from the only God. But do not think that I will accuse you before the Father in heaven. Your accuser is Moses, on whom your hopes are set. If you believed Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote about me. But since you do not believe what he wrote, how are you going to believe what I say?" Amen. That was Jesus speaking. Okay, excuse me. Jesus is the good shepherd. We studied that a couple weeks ago, John 10. Remember John 12:26. "Whoever serves me," this is Jesus speaking, "must follow me, and where I am, my servant will also be. My Father in heaven will honor the one who serves me." Amen. Go to John 17. After Jesus said this, he looked towards heaven and prayed, "Father, the time has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you, for you granted him authority over all the people, that he might give eternal life to all those you have given him. Now this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have brought you glory on the earth by completing the work on earth by completing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I have with you before the world began. I have revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours. You gave them to me, and they have obeyed your word. Now they know that everything you have given me comes from you. For I gave them the words you gave me, and they accepted them. They knew with certainty that I came from you, and they believed that you sent me. I pray for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those you have given that you have is mine. And glory has come to me through them. I will remain in the world no longer, but they are still in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name you gave me, so that they may be one, as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them and kept them safe by that name that you gave me. None has been lost except the one doomed to desolation, so that scriptures would be fulfilled. I am coming to you now, but I say these things while I am still in the world, so that they may have the full measure of my joy within them. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them. For they are not of the world. They are not of the world any more than I am of the world. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. For them, I sanctify myself, that they too may be truly sanctified. Jesus prays for future believers. My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me, though their message, that all of them may be one. Father in heaven, just as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I and them and you and me. May they be brought to complete unity, to let the world know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father in heaven, I want those you have given me to be with me, where I am, and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known in order that the love you have for me may be in them and that I myself may be in them. Amen. Okay, excuse me.
To each one of the manifestation means to make evident or known.
that the Spirit is given for the common good. To one, there is given through the Spirit the message of wisdom. To another, the message of knowledge by means by the same Spirit, To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by the same Spirit, by one Spirit. To another, miraculous powers. To another, prophecy. To another, distinguishing between spirits, means seeing the spirits. To another, speaking in different kinds of tongues. And still another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are the work of one and the same Spirit. He has given to each one just as He determines. Okay, let's go down to, give me a lot of Bible verses, so I'm going to get them all done today. Okay, Second Corinthians 13. Hold on, give me a second here. Okay, go to 1 Corinthians 13 first. Love. And I will show you the most excellent way, W-A-Y. If I speak in tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am only a resounding gong or a clang cymbal. I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries, all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains but have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angry. Rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres, means continues. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, they will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, which is an adult, I put childish ways behind me. Now we see but a poor reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part. Then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. I might not get them all done today. Okay, 2 Corinthians 1. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, and her brother. To the church of God in Corinth, together with all the saints throughout Arcadia. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise be to the God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received from God. For just as the suffering of Christ flow over into our lives, so also
Impurity, debauchery,
idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, disorder, jealousy, fits of rage, self-ambition, desertions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I've warned you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. So remember that. Amen, amen. He said he's giving me a lot of Bible verses, and I didn't get all of them done last week, so. Okay, go to Colossians 1. This is the supremacy of Christ. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him and through him. To reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace, P-E-A-C-E, peace, throughout his blood, shed on the cross. Once you were alienated from God, you were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. But now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. If you continue in your faith, established and firm, not moved from the hope held out in the gospel. In the gospel, this is the gospel that you heard and that has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven, and of which I, Paul, have become a servant. Now I rejoice in what was suffered for you, and I fill up in my flesh what is still lacking in regard to Christ's afflictions, for the sake of his blood, which is the church. I have become its servant, by the commission God gave me to present to you the word of God in its fullness, the mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations. It is now disclosed to the saints. God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of his mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. We proclaim him, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone perfect in Christ. To the end, I labor, struggle with all his energy, which so powerfully works in me. Amen. Amen. How great is our God? How great is our God? Okay, excuse me, I don't want to run out of minutes on my camcorder, and I got one song, so. Okay, now, number one, love, serve, and follow our Heavenly Father, be faithful to him. Number two, love and take care of your personal family, your spouse, and children. Number three comes work 40, 50 hours a week. Number four comes your friends. My number one purpose for my organization is to preach the gospel, the real God's truth. Number two is help people. Number three is help clean up our major cities and help make them a better and safer place to live. I've emailed the governor, Bruce Warner, on some issues, and Mayor Jim Artis and councilmen, such as some roads that need fixed and pole lights that are needed. the safe side and get it enforced, okay? TV station is calling me, so I'll be on TV this week. So people understand the severity of the issue and get it completely enforced and done. Saying is one thing and truly doing is another. Think if it was your child or grandchild, not just a child. We are to protect them as well. So for their safety, it is extremely important for them and their safety.
Earthquakes in Naples from a few months ago for the victims.
wildfire and drought for the victims. Dan, he has health problems. Margarita, she has health problems. Davey has severe asthma. John, Heather, and Donald, they are going through something personal. Donald's two older teenage daughters that are missing for their safety. Bobby's wife passed away over a year ago. Our president, for his caring and hard work for our country. Amen, amen there. Rulers of our states and cities, city schools, teachers, colleges, churches, pastors, farmers, policemen and women, firemen and women, servicemen and women, I'm praying for you all. Pray for each other, for my organization, songs, novels, and house I'm living in. And remember this week's sermon, aim for the Lord's perfection. Amen, amen. And remember, remember what I've been teaching you, WWJD, what we teach. Paper money and coins. Just lean on, put your total trust in and on Him. And do the right things, okay? And He will guide, protect, and shield us through and from them. So remember that, okay? Okay, thank you and God bless you, and I'll see you next week. Enjoy the nice weather while you can, while it's halfway nice out.